Hello, Airbus Cockpit Coach here, and welcome to the channel. Today we're going to look at the crosswind landing technique. I'm inside Microsoft Flight Simulator, currently paused on the approach to Edinburgh's runway 24 with the Fenix CEO. Before we commence the approach, I'm going to talk through the sort of standard techniques for the crosswind landing in the Airbus. Firstly, we need to understand our limits. So the Airbus 320 has a direct crosswind limit of 38 knots, and that does include gusts, so we need to ensure that those are factored in as well. If the wind is more of a headwind, it can be stronger. It's the crosswind component we're interested in. And the new SimBrief performance tools, which are now available for both takeoff and landing, are a great way for pilots in the sim to visualize, work out how much of that wind is a direct crosswind. So do have a look at that. In the real world, there are also operator specific limitations. For my operator, for example, the first officer is not allowed to conduct a landing when the direct crosswind is above 20 knots. So that then becomes a captain's landing for anything above 20 knots. In terms of aircraft configuration, it's generally accepted that if we're not expecting wind shear or turbulence, in strong winds, flap full is probably the best way to go. This is because on flaps full, with more drag out, we have a slightly higher thrust setting, which helps us with the speed on the approach in windy conditions. If we are expecting a reasonable amount of turbulence or indeed wind shear, that will always be a flaps free approach. In any case, flaps config free can be used. In terms of auto brake medium is the preferred choice in a strong crosswind. It reduces the time on the ground that we're compensating for the crosswind effect. The Airbus 320 has a very capable autopilot and is capable of tracking the centerline in very strong winds. Really important to build up a good mental picture of the approach so we can understand what we're likely to be seeing and preparing ourselves for that. I would advise configuring the aircraft early on, and you definitely want to be stable and configured by 1,000 feet. So when you're briefing for your crosswind approaches, just to make sure that you're going to consider configuring early, getting the flaps up, getting the gear down, so you can concentrate on flying the approach in the final stage. So for the approach, it's important that we track the center line. We've got a very unusual visual picture, as you'll see here. We've got the runway off to one side. Sometimes it can be all the way over in this window in the strongest wind cases. And you can see on the navigation display, we're heading about 255, but the runway's over in a 240 heading. Also see that a difference here at the bottom of the primary flight display. The green diamond is our track over the ground, and the yellow marker there is our heading, where the nose is pointing. You see we've got a good difference of about 15 degrees currently. So that's an unusual picture. It's important that we maintain the track by crabbing the aircraft into the wind at the appropriate angle to adjust for that wind effect. As the wind varies, we may need to adjust that crab angle. On the Airbus, crabbing is the taut technique for flying a crosswind approach. Up until about 50 feet, the approach is very normal, other than the unusual picture. It may be a bit more turbulent, but it's only really in the final stages from 50 feet through to the flare and touchdown that the rollout, that things are a little bit different. I would aim to flare at around 30 feet as normal and start bringing the power off. In terms of decrabbing the aircraft, so putting the rudder in to compensate, so in this case today we'll be using a left rudder input to compensate for the wind, which is coming from our right side, our starboard side, and hitting the tail of the aircraft, which subsequently pushes the nose over to the right. Depending on our rate of descent on touchdown, it would depend on how soon we decrab the aircraft. We're coming in at a reasonably normal rate of descent. at the same time we start flaring, we want to look at decrabbing the aircraft at the same time. So we start making a gradual, smooth rudder input, which we will hold. And it's important to note that we will keep that rudder input in after touchdown. You don't take it off, otherwise the aircraft will slide slip off to the upwind side of the runway. But it's really important to keep that rudder input in after touchdown. Upon touchdown, reverse thrust can be used as required. On a wet runway, we would aim to decrab the aircraft by 50% before touchdown in wet conditions. Ideally, on a dry runway, we want to be nose down the centre of the runway before touchdown or just as we touch down. In wet conditions, it's a little bit different. We'd aim to take about 50% of that crab angle off, and that's due to the aircraft potentially slipping on the runway. So there's a difference between dry and wet. Ideally, we do not want a long flare. We don't want to be aiming for a smooth touchdown. If we flare for a long time and drift down the runway, the aircraft will start slide slipping off downwind of the center line. They want to keep the flare to a minimum. Once we decrab, the aircraft is susceptible to then drifting downwind. So we want to ensure we're timing it right, to ensure that we're touching down as we're getting the aircraft fully decrabbed. If you do find that you're drifting downwind, we can apply some upwind aileron. You want to make sure that really that's no more than 5 degrees to avoid an engine nacelle strike or even a fairing on the wing. That's a technique to use to get the upwind landing gear to touch down first to stop the drift of the aircraft downwind. Generally in the Airbus, we don't make a lot of aileron inputs in the crosswind. The computers do a really good job in terms of balancing out the effects of the wind and the rudder input. In other aircraft, the rudder input would cause a roll effect on the ailerons, but on the Airbus, the computers compensate for you. On the rollout, we want to make sure that we're tracking the centerline as best as we can. Some slide slip is inevitable, we want to make sure we're recovering that and recovering it smoothly. We don't want to be making huge jerky inputs into the controls of the aircraft, so it's got to be gradual and smooth to track the runway centerline. During the flare, if you do find that you are off centerline, it's always better to be off centerline on the upwind side than the downwind side. That the wind's naturally obviously going to push you towards the downwind side, so it gives you a little bit more margin to play with. If you're drifting towards the downwind side, and that's the point where we would consider a go around. So let's unpause the simulator and continue the approach into Edinburgh's runway 24 and see that crosswind procedure in action. Lots of white chop on the waves, that's always a good indicator of a strong wind. Looking pretty fierce down there. Currently indicating 36 knots from our right side. So we're monitoring our track off the centre line. The green is the track. Yellows are heading. And the same here on the navigation display. You've got the green diamond is our track. That's our path across the ground. And the yellow marker there is where the nose is pointing. So at the moment we've got about 16 to 17 degree crab angle. The autopilot is, however, doing a great job. It does handle a crosswind very well on the Airbus. So I'll look to take manual control at 1,000 feet. Fully configured. Approach checklist are complete. Forty-three knots now on the side. That's quite a lot. That's above our crosswind limitation. The touchdown. So we're keeping an eye on that now. Autopilot's coming out. My control. Right. That wind's starting to come down with 38 knots, which is our limit, 37 now, so we're good on the wind. So that was the crosswind landing technique there. It's quite on the limit there, almost. So it's quite a strong crosswind, that one. Lots of use of left rudder. So I decrabbed there at 30 feet and maintained that left rudder input. I had to increase it upon touchdown as the aircraft still wanted to weathercock into the wind. And focus there was on maintaining that centre line. So it's really important to try and track centre line. We don't want to be drifting off. As I mentioned, it's avoid trying to aim for a smooth touchdown in these conditions. You want minimal float, get the aircraft down, so you can get it under control and stop that drift. Any questions on that, please drop them in chat. Please like and subscribe. And if you found that video useful, please consider buying me a coffee through the Buy Me Coffee link in the video description. Appreciated. Thanks for watching.